Good morning. What a beautiful day. Had a nice, uneventful trip here. Pulled into the parking lot. Got out, came in, spoke with Amanda back there. Pastor. Had an opportunity to just share some time before services. And it was just, everything was good. Except for I did have a moment of panic, and it was true panic. The other evening, when I was finishing up my lesson, I had taken my glasses and I put them up on top of my high boy dresser. I saw them there, but I forgot to take them. So I was sitting back there just before singing was to begin, and I went, and looking, oh my goodness, I forgot my glasses. Rushed out to my truck, and I looked in the dash area and what have you. I thought, oh no. But I remembered Friday was my last day of work, and I took a brand new case with three glasses in it, and I put them in a box, and put them in the back seat with all my other things I brought back. And so I have brand new glasses today, so it's a blessing. So, for a moment there when I was panicking, and now I can see clearly. So, anyway, let's begin class with a moment going to the Lord, asking His favor and blessings upon the lesson and upon the students who are downstairs, and that they would receive the much-needed instruction. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, as we approach Your throne of grace this morning, Lord, we are very grateful for the very fact that You have given us the opportunity to be here in this place on this beautiful day that You have created. And Lord, that You have made it possible for us to be here, that we are not hindered by the frailties of this body or situations of life which could have easily been a roadblock to our being here in person in church, Lord, be able to be amongst Your people. And Lord, we just ask that You would bless us for our efforts, Lord, to be here, that we didn't just choose to go elsewhere, but rather we chose to be here in Your house on this day, a day that we observe, Lord. But Lord, I know we have, this place has been established here as a beacon to this community, and Lord, You have placed us here, so let us be doing those things which are profitable in Your sight, that may be able to impact in a positive fashion those individuals who see us, come to meet us, those that may even attend services, Lord. And even for those individuals perhaps who are going to witness the lessons of the sermon via the internet or whatever means by which they tune in to these broadcasts, Lord, just ask a special blessing upon those individuals as well. And we invite them, Lord, that if they could, they would in person come and visit us here. And Lord, we ask that You would just forgive us of our shortcomings. Lord, we know in this flesh we tend to gravitate towards those things which are not profitable. And so we repent of those things, Lord. And we just desire that You would give us strength to persevere against all those temptations that are from without and even those that are from within, Lord. And we ask that You would bless the efforts of this church and all of its aspects, its outreaches, and that You would just see that individuals would be impacted for the positive in Your gospel and in all ways that we try to service You. Lord, we ask once again that You would be with us this morning, be with those who are in our hearts or many who are ill that are not able to be here with us this morning. Just ask Your healing hand upon them. And Lord, in these days, that things are seem to be rather chaotic in our society, in our culture, in our world, that You would just continue to, I'll say, see Your plan through, because we know that all these things have to come to pass, Lord, because Your return is very nigh. So we ask, Lord, that You would take care of those things as well. We ask all these things, favors, blessings, in Christ Jesus' name. And it's in His name we pray. Amen. So, First off, the holiday season, right, obviously is upon us once again. You only have, 14 days left to go out and purchase, wrap, and ship, or otherwise deliver those gifts that you intend for those to receive. Hopefully they'll be well received. Or maybe, right, you're one of those individuals who is very crafty, very clever, very artsy, right? And you're talented so that you can create something from basic materials, perhaps. I used to like to make things, right? And whether it's carving soapstone into little figurines or something out of wood or things of that nature. But those things you can always create, perhaps, and they might be even viewed as even more sentimental in value to those individuals who you may be willing to give them to. So if you're one who creates things like that, I give you a great deal of praise. Either way, neither of these gift-giving methods would be possible without the use of technology. And that's what we're going to talk about today, right? When does technology become too much of a good thing? And so we're going to kind of look at this topic. It's a topic that has, I want to say I have thought about quite a bit. And there are many instances in the scriptures where we can see technology being utilized for the positive. So in this present day and age, it's almost impossible to escape being exposed to, touched by, or entangled by multiple forms of technology. The reason being, we are virtually enveloped by technology at every turn. From the time we wake up in the morning to the moment you hit the sheets at night, we all live beneath an umbrella of technology. I imagine we all woke up this morning to an electric alarm clock. We utilized indoor plumbing, yay, central air and heat, and electric lighting. Perhaps we enjoyed a cup of coffee from our programmable percolator, or enjoyed a glass of cold, ice-cold orange juice from the refrigerator. We prepared our breakfast using a gas or electric stovetop, or popped something into the microwave oven. Of course, if you're like most Baptists, you probably only had time for some dry toast from your toaster before piling into the automobile and racing off to church while checking your antiquated wristwatch to see if you're going to be on time for Sunday school. From the myriad of electrical devices in your house, to the smartphone in your pocket, to the clothes on your back, we all benefit from technology. It is inescapable and plays an essential role in our daily lives. I think we can all agree. The reality is, we all have become so used to these daily conveniences that we often take them for granted. Until, that is, we become inconveniently deprived of them. When a blown fuse or trip breaker leaves us without power, it can cause us distress, even if it's only temporary. If our automobile refuses to start in the morning, we may get angry and actually hurl verbal abusive words at it, as if this inanimate object is going to listen to you. But it feels better when you call it, you stupid piece of junk, I don't know, it just makes you feel better. And we've always, I'm going to say, we probably all have experienced that. When you get in the car, you expect it to start. By golly, you bought it for that reason, to convey you from one point to the next, and when it doesn't start, it just frustrates you. And if, heaven forbid, we have forgotten our phone at home or forgot to place it on its charger, we may experience an outright panic attack or emotional meltdown. I've seen that personally. Matter of fact, I've been many miles away from home and had to turn my car around to go back to retrieve my wife's phone because she had to have her phone. Well, it all sounds absurd, but that's exactly how dependent we have all become to these and other wonderful advancements in technology. Now, I've used the word technology quite a bit. I think we should probably look at its definition. An idealistic definition of technology would be the invention of useful things to solve problems. Anything beneficial and non-harmful that is invented with the sole purpose of improving human lives. That's an idealistic definition. Better living through innovation has been said. So, In other words, things created with the expressed intention of making life easier and more pleasurable. Or at least, that is one definition, because not all technology has been invented with such noble intentions. And those that may have been designed for good and benign purposes have been commandeered and corrupted to serve a different use. Technologies that are both promising and dangerous, such as nuclear energy, by which we also get nuclear weapons. Something invented, something new to technology that had the promise, and yet at the same time it also brought destruction. So because the definition of technology encompasses many things, from the most primitive, such as the discovery of fire and the development of the wheel, to much more complex inventions like the movable type printing press, or the internal combustion engine, all the way to today where we have photovoltaic solar panels, global positioning satellites, and space exploration. Today's technology and innovations are progressing at such a fast pace that which we may have purchased new just a few short months ago may be considered as antiquated or even obsolete now. That's how quick technology moves. So perhaps it's time to tap the brakes a bit. This is my opinion. Now, specifically for this lesson, we're going to concentrate our attention upon those facets of technology that involve things like communication, smart technology, social media networks, and computer software programs. Because it seems like that everything that we have is as a result of these things. You know, the clothes that you have, a lot of this is automated. You know, they have a computer software program, and it programs the machines to do all the stitching that they need to do. You've probably seen assembly lines of automobiles where you see these robots come down, and it's all programmed. You know, it's not just haphazard. These robots are told exactly how far they're to move laterally and horizontally, you know, and where they're supposed to go and what have you. And it's all because of computers. So it may seem odd that someone like me would bring a lesson about such things. After all, I'm admittedly stubborn and generally resistant to adopting or learning or participating in the latest techno trends or fads regarding that kind of technology. I really am. I don't do any social media. I don't even want my picture on the internet. My kids will tell you I'm adamant about that. Don't not post my picture. Because with today's technology, who knows where that picture's going to end up? You know, I'd rather just be left out of it altogether. Things like social media, networking, and gaming platforms may be intriguing to the younger generation, but I come from an earlier one. I grew up using sophisticated inventions like landline telephones that you ordered from Ma Bell when you had your phone service installed. And the guy who came in to hook him up, he was from Ma Bell, or Bell Telephone, if you will. And you had a choice. You could pick your phone in any color that was available. But your phone was a contraption like this. And then they got really swift, and they had a real narrow one you could hang on the wall. But beforehand, it was just rotary phones. You remember those? Took you forever. If you had somebody with a real long number that all had a lot of nines in it, that was exhaustive, wasn't it? And had to wait for that to come all the way back. However, like I say, I come from a different generation. I was of the generation who was able to watch any one of four stations we could pick up with our roof-mounted antenna. And we watched ABC, CBS, NBC on our vacuum tube television set until the station stopped broadcasting at midnight. And if you were lucky, you had a color television. Because I remember watching black and white for quite many years there when I was younger. We listened to music on transistor radios, vinyl records, and 8-track tapes. We used maps printed on paper to find our way to those previously unvisited destinations we were traveling to. And we were content. We were content. We thought, you know, hey, this is awesome. But technology marches on and has become as indelible and indispensable part of everyday life for much of our modern society. Can't not stave off technology. And that all includes the Lord's New Testament church. We have not been isolated from the advancements. And there are many advancements that have been beneficial. For many years now, our worship and song services have been enhanced using microphones and amplifiers, like we heard this morning. And as of just recently, our Sunday school lessons and sermons utilize TV monitors and are streamed live and recorded using computer software. That's an advancement. I was informed recently that viewers are even able to financially support this church's ministry electronically if they wish to. I don't believe we're set up to accept Bitcoin, but I could be mistaken. So if anyone online wants to support the ministry of this church, you're more than welcome to. We are very grateful. All of these innovations represent genuine benefits that have been made possible by technology. In fact, the Lord's New Testament churches have used every advancement throughout history to communicate of communication to reach people with the gospel message, beginning with the sending of letters. You know, even the apostles sent letters, and to the writing of books. And then say, to get our voices over, we used megaphones, the most rudimentary, just basically a tube with no electrical enhancement whatsoever, just a tube to magnify our voices so we could speak above the sound of the crowd or what have you. We have utilized magazines, movies, broadcasting on television and over the radio. Now, finally, we utilize the internet, which utilizes satellites where the message can be sent all across the world. Those are all good, acceptable, and beneficial uses of this type of technology. However, since technology has become so pervasively entrenched in our culture and society, some people are recommending hitting the proverbial pause button and asking some very thought-provoking questions, such as, what are the negative side effects or downsides to the use of some of these forms of technology? Regardless if you consider yourself a progressive individual or one who yearns for a simpler type of life, these are important questions we need to ask ourselves. What are we losing by adapting to these types of technology? What damage could it be doing to the saved or unsaved individual and their family unit? Is the growing influence of social media, information technology, detrimental to the mental, psychological, and spiritual health for Christians and the church body? Well, it appears that the answer is yes. There are currently attorneys at law who are pursuing legal action against the developers, programmers, and distributors of software which contain harmful material, and they are backed up by the findings of notable mental health professionals. I'll go a little bit further here. According to one law firm's website, there has become an alarming increase in social media addiction. Social media addiction is a type of behavioral addiction, an activity or act that a person is dependent or craves. This is characterized by an urge consistently to use social media. According to the U.S. Surgeon General, up to 95% of youth ages 13 through 17 use social media platforms, with more than a third saying that they use social media almost constantly, while nearly 40% of children ages 8 to 12 use social media. My little granddaughter, who will be 9 on Christmas Day, she uses social media in that she goes to a gaming program. She's addicted to it. I truly believe this to be true. She really likes it. It's basically innocuous kind of a program. You know, it's not like it has violence or anything like that. But whatever is in this particular software program, this game, it has become an addiction to her. I really truly believe this. Another thing we see is individuals who use selfies, right? But not just selfies alone. It's selfies in conjunction with Photoshop, okay? Because, you know, we all want to look good, right? So they'll do selfies, but then they'll alter the picture to make sure that they look really good in their selfies. And then they'll present a false representation of who they are on the internet. You know? How often have we seen this where you see all these clips? You see it in advertising all the time. I mean, you know, I feel like I must be the guy on the outside because I should have multicultural friends about my age all sitting around on the weekend, you know, throwing back some beers and enjoying a meal together and conversing. You see all these commercials, and that's what they portray. Mostly younger people, right? But you see that you got people from every nationality, you know, that's wonderful. I think it'd be great. You can minus the alcohol, but the point being is that's what they are portraying in advertising. Whatever they're trying to sell that this is ideally what your life should look like. That's not what life looks like, right? Life is not filled with all these actors who, you know, are, you know, perhaps considered some of the more beautiful people in the world. You know, not everybody is as attractive, perhaps, as some of these individuals on TV. But you'll find that a lot of people gravitate towards that, and they feel like they don't measure up. And as a consequence, they have some problems. They develop problems. Going through, in regards to this software program and these cases that have been brought, it says the findings state that children and teens who compulsively use social media may be at risk of developing serious physical and mental health problems, including suicidal thoughts, self-harm, depression, eating disorders, ADD, ADHD, distorted self-image, lack of focus, etc., etc., etc. Additionally, adolescents who spent more than 3 hours per day on social media faced double the risk of experiencing poor mental health outcomes, including the symptoms of depression and anxiety. Some of the signs of social media addiction are listed below. I'll read some of these to you and see whether or not you agree. And these are potential problems that may arise by the excessive use of social media. Individuals spending a lot of time thinking about social media, increased screen time on social media apps, spending hours on social media, feeling urges to consistently check social media. That's another one, you know, always checking their phone. You know, half the generation out there I recognize like this. I don't see their face, I see their head. They're down in their phone like this all the time. The amazing thing is, you'll have a lot of them, they'll be in a crowd, they'll all be like this. They're not talking to one another, or maybe they are. You know what I'm saying? They could be standing right there and you're texting one another. I'm sorry, it's incredible. It just seems so silly. But to be honest with you, that's where our society seems to be going with our young people. Some of the other things. Feeling urges to constantly check social media. Fear of missing out on social media. Staying up late, scrolling through social media, using social media to forget about personal problems, unable to reduce use of social media, losing that capability, needing to spend more time on social media to feel good about themselves, having withdrawal systems when not on social media. My daughter, actually all my daughters, feel that whenever we go camping, we go to a location that is where we don't get any cell reception. Oh my goodness, that's some real dedication to the family to go with us to a location where you can't get cell service. They can't use their phones. Anyways, feeling anxious, restless, or upset if unable to use social media, using social media while eating or with others, happens a lot. Spending less time with friends and family, happens a lot. Difficulties making or keeping friends, problems with family and social relationships, giving up important or desirable social recreational activities for social media instead. Neglecting responsibilities at home, work, or school happens. I can tell you this happens. Mood changes, yes. Low self-esteem, feeling isolated, social anxiety disorder, problems sleeping, psychological harm, physical harm, other social media addiction signs. These are all the things that are listed. And as a consequence, those parents and families who claim their children have suffered harm after compulsively or excessively using social media platforms such as Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, Snapchat, and or YouTube, are seeking to hold these companies accountable. So they're seeking the correction, whatever means of correction. Some of them said that there needs to be, things put in place that prevent children from becoming so addicted, and that these companies have neglected to put those particular aspects of their programs in place, because they want exactly that. Just like the tobacco companies want you to become addicted to nicotine. That way you keep buying their product. Same thing with these companies. They want you to become addicted, so you'll constantly be on their website, so their advertisers can be seen, so they can make the money. It's all about money. It's all about money. And if they can control human beings on a very fundamental level, their psychological selves, then that's exactly what they'll do. In addition to the problems that plague social media, entertainment media software games can have their problems as well. I know that my son Aaron used to play those car racing ones. What was that thing called? I don't remember. Can't remember, Tiffany. He was always on there playing those on his whatever program. But anyways, he would just be totally, immersed into it. And a couple of years back, we were going to the zoo in Fresno. From my house to the Fresno Zoo is about 45 minutes, an hour, something like that. Oh my goodness. I had to get up in the fast lane right next to two diesel rigs and just mirror their speed to stop him from going past me. He was driving like a maniac on the freeway. You know, and he's not alone, because, you know, if you want to see that kind of stuff, just get on the freeway between where I live in Turlock to Ceres, and you're going to find somebody out there practicing to be in the Indy 500 or something, you know, and they just drive like crazy. And I really, truly believe that a lot of this gaming programs that these kids use, where they're racing these cars, in a virtual reality, want to see what it's like in real life. And the outcome is not good. So anyway, computer-generated images, this is something else I wanted to bring to you. Those computer-generated images are becoming increasingly indistinguishable from living individuals. Our technology is getting so good, has so become so advanced, that it's almost impossible for you to look at the image that they're portraying and not think that's a real actor playing that part. Couple that with interactive capabilities and virtual immersive headsets, and you can participate in virtually any experience imaginable. And I mean that. Every experience imaginable, whether it's for entertainment purposes or whether it's to delve into an area that you ought to stay away from. And game makers purposely design their software to seduce, entice, enthrall, and captivate their audiences. I mean, hey, you know, everybody wants to sell your product, right? So you do what you can to sell it. But there's consequences. And some of these companies that do these things really need to, show a little bit more compassion to their users. So here's one thing that they use, right? Whenever you play a game where it has an individual that's supposed to represent you, right? That becomes what they call an avatar, evidently, right? So I looked up the definition of avatar. If you look it up, this is what you'll find, at least wise I did when I just put define avatar. The first definition identifies it as a manifestation of a deity or released soul in bodily form on earth, an incarnate divine teacher. The second, of course, is what we're more accustomed to, and that is an icon or figure representing a particular person in video games, internet forums, etc. But I find the relative comparison rather disturbing. You know, a deity or released soul in bodily form on earth? That sounds almost a little too satanic for me. Avatars that allow the user to indulge in everything you can imagine, whatever your passion may be at any moment, they have a software program you can get into. I see these advertisements come across my computer when I was at work, and they say, you know, for individuals 18 years or older, a software game only for those individuals 18 or older. Well, what does that entail? You know, if a kid can't play it, I certainly don't want to. Remember the good old days? My computer software programming, or rather not program, but usage, was Pong. You remember Pong? Pong was such a great game. I loved that game. Had one paddle here, and a little dot went back and forth. And your job was to make sure that that dot didn't be past your paddle. That was a wonderful game. Didn't have any violence in it. Didn't have any sex in it. Didn't have anything. All you had to do was just keep that ball from getting past your paddle. That was a wonderful game. But again, you know, people, I guess, get tired of those things, and they want to get involved in others. So, and the latest disturbing software to come to market is an AI design program. I don't know if you guys have seen this, but when I saw it, it's an AI design program which would allow you to be capable of seeing and interacting with a deceased loved one. Perhaps your mother who passed away from cancer, or your brother who died in a car accident, right? In a program that will make an individual look exactly like your loved one who's passed away. And they will even, if you have recorded recordings of them speaking or what have you, will take those recordings, allow the AI to listen to them, compile them, and the AI can actually interact with you while you're wearing your headset. It's one of those virtual reality things, okay? And you can talk to your dead loved one. Although the software programs insist that their motives are pure, they're crossing a line. The desire to reconnect with the people we've lost is a basic longing. And it's no surprise that these designers and engineers have started exploring how to exploit people when they are at their most vulnerable. There's two friends who started up a company called Paranormal Games, and today they are developing a particular personalized experience in which users can visit with 3D model of their dead relative, friend, whatever the case may be, for a personalized experience in which they can meet with these individuals in a virtual reality setting. It all seems rather morbid to me. Am I the only one who finds this disturbing? Of a certainty, mourning the loss of a loved one is a painfully difficult matter. But the grieving process is just that. It is a process. One that everyone from literally time immemorial has had to endure and eventually become reconciled with. However, using such virtual reality programs may have severe negative effects upon the emotional well-being, may contribute to emotional psychosis. People that can't get over the loss of a loved one to the point where they want to have a virtual reality interaction with their loved one, where AI is really calling the shots, AI's speaking to them. You get where I'm coming from? I think that this is getting a little bit carried away. But yet, software programmers are using this to take advantage of individuals who are at their most vulnerable. The software designers contend that they aren't about recreating an absolutely real version of the deceased person. The world they're creating is not intended to be a kind of second life for the dead. It's meant to be what this individual would call a virtual sanctuary, almost like the online version of visiting a cemetery. Users will be able to specify the setting, say that might have to be a favorite place of yours in your loved one, wherever it might be. But the goal isn't for users to escape, according to them, into a virtual space where they might risk emotionally and mentally losing themselves in a fantasy. They charge, "We are not chasing realism. In fact, we are aiming more toward hyper-realism," they say. "The human models and physical settings will be as realistic as possible, but the world that they will be in will always have a bright colored dreamscape look and feel on the fringes, such as a fog surrounding the borders of the environment. It's this fog out of which avatars of the deceased will emerge and retreat. Further, the deceased models will have a slight glow to remind users that the world isn't real. It wouldn't overwhelm you so much that it takes the experience away, but it would visually keep reminding you where you are. So they say. One commentator wrote, "The very notion of virtual reanimation seems fraught, to say the least. While literature and film have explored the horrific side of life after death misadventures, modern attempts to revisit the departed seem destined to end simply in more heartache." And I would have to agree with that. I think these people have lost their minds in pursuit of gain. They don't care about their audience. If their audience gravitates towards sin, immoral behavior, things like that, they'll write you a program for it, as long as they ain't getting the money. Society, has its problems, but there's always someone out there who will utilize technology to fill their desires. We talked about some of the inventions that we consider to be beneficial, right? And I don't recall if the Gutenheim press was the one with movable type, but leastwise it was, because I know that they used to take, back in the day, if they were going to, say, copy a Bible, it was either by hand, or if they were fortunate enough, you had people who would take a block of wood, and they would carve out whatever, and in a relief fashion, by the way, it's obvious, they would carve it out, and then they'd go ahead and put the ink on all everything, and then they would press that block of wood, you'd have one page of the Bible. The problem came is that if you did something wrong, made a mistake, or one of the particular letters or something got broken, you would have to redo the whole thing because it wasn't really easy to repair. But they came out with a movable type, and that changed everything. I mean, everything that we got from that point on, whether it was a textbook or whether it was the Bible itself, it became something that was available in multitudes to many people rather than just one. And matter of fact, with movable type, you could do it in different languages, whereas if you carved down a big block, that was just probably Latin, and you didn't get it in your own language. But with movable type, you could actually have a document, a Bible page, a thing of that nature, that's printed in your own language, and, it was easy enough for them to move things about. However, and that was a positive thing, very positive thing. But as I mentioned, the technology can be corrupted, commandeered for other purposes. And so that which gave us the Bible also gave us pornography. The misuse of printing presses to go from publishing something as beautiful as this to something as vile as some of the things you see on some of these magazine racks. That's what I'm talking about, how technology, unabated, unresisted, can really be a bad thing. This kind of wisdom, James 3:15 says, "This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, and devilish." Advancements in communication tools can help us share the gospel, connect with more people, and stay in touch with our families and friends. But technology cannot share the gospel for us to replace the need for in-person relationships. That's why we assemble here. Right? Our purpose is to make disciples. That's what we were commanded to do. There's a need for the church to have a physical presence. At its core, the church is an assembly of people who gather together with each other in person for that very purpose, to forward or to further the cause of Christ, to share that gospel. Paul wrote, "And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, insomuch the more as you see the day approaching. I see the day approaching. We're being attacked at every angle. Our children are being assaulted, essentially, over the internet, using these different media programs. It's very disturbing, very unsettling for our grandfather to see his granddaughter become addicted to a game, to where she doesn't want to go out and play. She'd rather just be on a computer. But that's the life that we see nowadays. We do not know that when Jesus is coming, but we do know the time is growing very late. And the question we need to ask ourselves is, are we prepared to meet him? Are we prepared to give him that which he is due? Technology certainly is a mixed bag of blessings and curses. Used for the good, it has solved numerous problems around the world. It has alleviated many diseases, and it has improved the quality of life for billions of people. But also, on the other hand, technology can be used to inflict pain and suffering, and it can lead to consequences which are not acceptable, whether they're unintentional or whether they're just designed that way. We must guard ourselves from simply dismissing, rejecting, or demonizing technology without doing a thorough examination first. Right? We don't want to just say, all technology is bad. No, not all technology is bad. And as a matter of fact, God does not hate technology. The misuse of technology, I'm certain he hates. So we shouldn't just, I want to say, dismiss it altogether, right? Or demonize it. However, we also should not be mindlessly acceptant of it, to use and endorse it. We need to do some discerning. We need to exercise due precaution. So when the question is, has technology gone too far? My question is, how much farther is it going to go? Now, they've been talking about, and you guys probably have seen it, where AI has been embodied, a synthetic body, plastic, metal, silicone, whatever, and they try to make it look real, like a real human being, and they give them a persona. And they're able to interact with human beings, where you can speak to these things, and they'll speak back to you. Some of these things that they say is very alarming. And many individuals who, you might respect for their business sense, or their place in government even, are throwing their precautions out there, saying, you know what, we need to be very careful what we do with the technology that we're able to do now. I don't want to be one who says all technology ought to be halted. Because I think, you know what, if we really put AI to work, why not we just go ahead and write a program and have AI find a cure for cancer? If AI is so terribly smart, from what I understand, it can certainly think and come to, some answers to certain things that it would be difficult for us to do. Set it on a job that would be beneficial for mankind. Once you find a cure for cancer, or every other dreaded disease that plagues human life. Set it about finding the answer to cold fusion, right? Something that we would benefit from in this world. Utilize technology in its best sense. But the problem is, there's just too many people out there that want to corrupt it. And we suffer as a consequence. So, again, when is it too much? I don't know. I don't know where that line's going to get drawn. I guess when the Lord returns, that's when it will have been too much. Maybe technology is going to be the indicator. The advancements, where we can do the worst to our own selves through innovation. Well, I'm going to leave you with that. That's my that's my old man talking about new technology lesson for today. Just be careful what you buy. If for Christmas you're thinking of getting a software program for your grandchildren or your children or things of that nature, you might want to do a little investigation into it and see just how addictive that might be. Thank you.
All is calm and all is bright everywhere, but in your heart tonight they're singing carols of joy and peace. But you feel too far gone and too far out of reach. Somewhere in your silent night, heaven hears the song you're